Well, thank you for coming this spring. It seemed like just the other day we were having our big rally, and all of you met that night on Sunday. And COVID has been a little challenging to get everybody out, but I tell you, hadn't you enjoyed just being together, eating breakfast, and having a good time fellowshipping? Amen. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Luke chapter 16. In just a moment, we'll start reading in verse 19. Luke chapter 16, verse 19 and following. I'm going to talk to you about hell, and it is a sobering subject. If you talk about hell nowadays, most people think it's ridiculous. Bertrand Russell was a British essayist and a philosopher, and he lived from 1872 to 1970. He lived 98 years. In his book, Why I Am Not a Christian, he denounced the concept of hell. He said, and I quote, "I do not myself feel that any person who is really profoundly human can believe in everlasting punishment. I must say that I think all this doctrine that hellfire is a punishment for sin is a doctrine of cruelty." The problem with that is he's in hell right now. His view is popular in our day. It is popular to not believe in hell. Even many preachers don't believe in hell. They reject the idea of God causing anybody to suffer eternally. But according to Jesus, according to Scripture, hell is real. It's a literal place of suffering, and Jesus said so. Jesus spoke about hell just as much as Jesus spoke about heaven. Now, I don't hear people complaining about his teachings on heaven, but I do hear people complaining about his teachings on hell. In fact, no one in the Bible spoke more about hell than Jesus. So if you don't believe in hell, you're actually calling Jesus a liar. I mean, you can't dismiss that. The most vivid, detailed description that Christ ever gave concerning hell is this parable of a rich man and a man named Lazarus, not the one that was raised from the dead, but another man named Lazarus. James Montgomery Boyce said this about the text that we're going to look at. He said, "This is the only passage in the entire Bible," now listen, "that describes the actual thoughts, emotions, and words of someone who is in hell. Hell itself is described elsewhere. There are warnings against it, but this is the only description of a person suffering in hell." The title of this is, "I Believe in Hell." Luke 16, look at verse 19. "Now there was a rich man, he habitually dressed in purple and fine linen, joyously living in splendor every day. A poor man named Lazarus was laid at his gate, covered with sores, longing to be fed with the crumbs which were falling from the rich man's table. Besides, even the dogs were coming and licking his sores. Now the poor man died and was carried away by the angels to Abraham's bosom," that's heaven, "and the rich man also died and was buried in Hades." I'll tell you, that's hell. We'll talk about that in a moment. "Lifted up his eyes, being in torment, he saw Abraham far away, Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried out and said, 'Father Abraham, have mercy on me. Send Lazarus so that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool off my tongue, for I'm in agony in this flame.' But Abraham said, 'Child, Remember that during your life you received your good things, likewise Lazarus' bad things, but now he's being comforted here and you're in agony. Besides all this, between us and you, there is a great chasm fixed, so that those who wish to come over from here to you will not be able, and that none may cross over from there to us. And he said, then I beg you, Father, that you send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, in order that he may warn them, so that they will also not also come to this place of torment. But Abraham said, they have Moses and the prophets, that is, they have the Old Testament scriptures. I'm so sorry. Let them hear them. But he said, no, Father Abraham. But if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent. But he said, if they don't listen to Moses and the prophets, if they don't listen to the scriptures, they will not be persuaded, even if somebody rises from the dead. And you can almost hear Jesus thinking, even if that is me, the Messiah, that rises from the dead. The actuality of hell, let's just talk about it. Now, all I'm going to do is just take some representative scriptures and read them to you to prove to you that Jesus, there is no way that Jesus was not speaking of a literal hell. This is just the verses out of Matthew. I've done this with you before, but I want to give you these. And if somebody ever says to you, I don't believe in hell, and say, well, Jesus did, just give it to them. Here it goes. Matthew 5:22. But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother shall be guilty before the court. Whoever says to his brother, you good for nothing, shall be guilty before the Supreme Court. Whoever says, you fool, shall be guilty enough to go into the fiery hell. There it is. Matthew 5:29 and 30. If your right eye makes you stumble, tear it out, throw it from you. It's better for you to lose one of the parts of your body than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. Now, I just have to comment here and say, going to hell is a lot worse than having your body physically dismembered. That's, just imagine somebody just taking you apart one body piece at a time. Jesus said you'd be better off for that to happen than for you to go to hell. If your right hand makes you stumble, cut it off and throw it from you. It's better for you to lose one of the parts of your body than for your whole body to go into hell. Notice you're going to have a resurrected body that is in heaven, but also eventually you have a resurrected body that's in hell if you go to hell to be united with your spirit and soul. Matthew 10:28, don't fear those who kill the body, that's people, but are unable to kill the soul, but rather fear him who is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. Matthew 11:23, and you, Capernaum, will not be exalted to heaven, will you? You will descend to Hades, for if the miracles had occurred in Sodom, remember that? Sodom and Gomorrah, fire and brimstone, which occurred in you, it would have remained to this day. Matthew 13:41 and 42, the Son of Man will send forth his angels, and they will gather out of his kingdom all stumbling blocks, those who commit lawlessness. They will throw them into the furnace of fire. In that place, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Notice, the whole concept of, you know, ceasing to exist, you go to hell and just get burned up. No, that's not what it says. It says there will be continual weeping and gnashing of teeth. Hell is eternal. Eternal. Matthew 25:41. Then he will also say to those on his left, depart from me, accursed ones, into the eternal fire, which has been prepared for the devil and his angels. Matthew 25:46, you have hell and heaven in one verse. Hell comes first. These will go away into eternal punishment, and the righteous into eternal life. Now, do I like to talk about this? No. But if you teach the whole Bible, you have to teach the whole truth. You can't just preach about heaven and how wonderful it is. You got to preach about hell and how horrible it is, and that's the actuality of hell. Now let's look at the attributes of hell, and let's look at our text in Luke 16. Now the poor man died, verse 22, The passing of possessions. Let's look at that very quickly. The passing of possessions. Luke 16:22. That's going to be an attribute of hell. You're not going to have any possessions in hell. Now the poor man died and was carried away by the angels to Abraham's bosom, and the rich man also died and was buried. At the first of the parable, the rich man was mentioned first, and Lazarus was mentioned last, but now Jesus mentions Lazarus' death before that of the rich man. I think that's kind of a great reversal, don't you? Do you remember when Jesus said in Matthew 20, verse 16, so the last shall be first, and the first shall be last? That's what you have here. It's a big reversal. Lazarus died of exposure, hunger, disease. We aren't told the cause of the rich man's death. It may have been that he was just, you know, a fat cat. He may have been obese. We don't know. But he died. And regardless, he died and left behind all of his earthly possessions. More than likely, his five brothers that he referred to later on in the text were arguing over his immense riches. I have seen families divided after parents die and children, siblings, fighting over possessions. And just like this rich man, everybody is going to leave all of his possessions behind. If you die without Jesus, you will go to hell and you will not take anything with you. Nothing. Your possessions will not accompany you. Everything, the house, the cars, all of it, clothes, whatever, it's going to be left behind. Paul said to Timothy in 1 Timothy 6, verse 7, for we have brought nothing into the world, so we cannot take anything out of it either. That's the passing of possessions. That's the first attribute of hell. And then notice in hell there's the absence of angels, good angels. Look at Luke 16, verse 22. Now the poor man died and was carried away by the angels to Abraham's bosom, and the rich man also died and was buried. Lazarus died, and we're not told whether he was buried or not. It's very likely that he was not. They would take poor people like him with emaciated bodies, and they would take them out through the dung gate to Gehenna, the Valley of Hinnom, which is where Molech and Baal worship took place. It was the garbage dump of Jerusalem. If you go there today, you can still see the Valley of Hinnom, and it goes right down by the wall of Jerusalem. And that's where they had all these horrible places where they would sacrifice babies, and it was just terrible what they did. And they called it Topheth. Topheth is the beating of the drums, and they would literally beat the drums so loud that they couldn't hear the babies screaming as they threw them onto these. They would heat these idols up just as hot as they could, red hot, and they just lay the babies on top of them and fry them. It was just terrible. Throw them in the fire. It was horrible. And so that's where more than likely his body was thrown, down in Gehenna at the dung gate, at the garbage dump, and it was burned with the rest of the rubbish. Nevertheless, even though his body was not treated right, angels attended his funeral. You know, he didn't have any pallbearers, but he had some soul bearers, amen? He had some soul bearers that took him to heaven. And more than likely, the rich man had an elaborate funeral. I had read one commentary that said, vast mourning, that is, people mourning for him, hundreds of friends, great display of honor. Now listen, but no angels. No angels. Angels accompany Christians to heaven when they die, but dead, lost people don't receive that kind of escort. Will angels escort you to heaven? That's the absence of angels. Another attribute of hell is it's a dismal descent. Look at Luke 16:23. In Hades, he lifted up his eyes. Being in torment, he was looking up. He had descended into hell. Lazarus had ascended into heaven. Lazarus went up, the rich man went down into hell. And I believe it's not just physical down, I believe it is spiritual down, emotionally down, and heaven is spiritually and emotionally up, but it's also physically up. Jesus mentioned this in Matthew 11, 23, and you, Capernaum, will not be exalted to heaven, will you? You will descend to Hades. Now, what is Hades and what is hell? What is all that? Hades is the best way to say it is, like if you go out here and you commit a crime, they're going to arrest you, but they don't send you to the penitentiary. They send you to the local jail, okay? That's Hades. The minute a lost person dies, they go to Hades. And this is a picture of Hades that we're looking at. And there's fire, and there's brimstone, and they're held there until the final judgment. You know, you're held in the local jail until you go through trial, right? And then after the trial, the judge sentences you, and then you go to the penitentiary. So, if you will, just in a regular way of saying it, when you read the word Hades, place of the dead, it's usually referring to people going to hell, yes, but it is the hell that is the keeping place until the eternal lake of fire. It's all fire, but the lake of fire is the entire time of eternity on the other side of the judgment seat of Christ. Do you understand what I'm saying? And so what you've got is what happens to a Christian? They go to paradise. What did Jesus say to the guy on the cross? Today you will be with me in what? Paradise. What is that? That's heaven. Yes, it's heaven. It's the presence of Jesus. But we also know that after the judgment seat and all of that, we are going to be in this elaborate New Jerusalem, new heavens, new earth, and all that. So paradise is wonderful. It's heaven. But heaven eternally will be the other that we read about in Revelation. So that's all I can talk about that right now. That's a whole doctrine, but we can talk about it later. But I just want you to see that when you die, you're either going to ascend or descend. And if you go to hell, you're descending. You're going down. Then there's a sobering separation. Luke 16, 23. In Hades, he lifted up his eyes, being in torment, and he saw Abraham far away and Lazarus in his bosom. Lazarus lived helplessly outside this rich man's elaborate home. He was at the gate on the earth, and the rich man now is living helplessly outside of the gates of heaven for all eternity. Do you see the switch? It's very poetic. I mean, this is one of the most, as far as literature, there are more contrast and pictures in this parable probably than any other parable that Jesus told. If you reject Jesus, you go to hell. That's what happens. Like the rich man, you'll be far from everybody else, your family, your friends, your neighbors, but most of all, you'll be separated from God forever. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 8 and 9, I read this just a day or two ago in my quiet time. He will punish those who don't know God and do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. They'll be punished with everlasting destruction, shut out from the presence of the Lord and from the majesty of His power. A sobering separation. Another attribute is it'll be an agonizing awareness. Luke 16:23. In Hades, he lifted up his eyes, being in torment, saw Abraham far away, Lazarus in his bosom. There's this conscious existence for everybody after death, either in heaven or in hell. You don't stop thinking. And I want to say this to you, there are zero atheists in hell. So I thought that's where they went. They were atheists when they went there, but about 2 seconds into it, they weren't atheists anymore. Those who die rejecting Jesus on earth go to hell, and within seconds of arriving in hell, they renounce their foolish thoughts about the non-existence of God, but it will be everlastingly too late. In hell, the rich man here realized that Lazarus was occupying a seat of honor and resting and feasting alongside Abraham. I mean, that's as high as you can get for a Jew at that time. All the while, he was suffering and burning in hell. Death is a relief to any suffering Christian on earth, but for the lost, death is not a relief. It is torment and agony. Charles Spurgeon, one of my favorite preachers, said, "If there be one thing in hell worse than any other, it will be seeing the saints in heaven. Oh, to think of seeing my mother in heaven while I am cast out. Husband, yonder is your wife in heaven, and you are among the damned. And do you see your father? Your child is before the throne, and you, accursed God of God and man, are in hell. Oh, the hell of hells will be to see our friends and loved ones in heaven, but ourselves lost." Again, if you die without Jesus, you will go to hell. You say, "I don't believe in hell." So what? If you die without Jesus, you will go to hell. You will. And for all eternity, you're going to be aware that there's a God who wanted to save you, that you blatantly rejected salvation through faith in Christ, and you rejected everlasting life. You'll live in torment and agonizing awareness. Then there will be this merciless misery. Look at verse 24. He cried out and said, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me. And send Lazarus so that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool off my tongue, for I'm in agony in this flame." Lazarus begged for scraps while he was on earth. But now, see the rich man beg for all eternity for one drop of water. He had no doubt tasted the finest of wines every day. He had his choice. And now he's begging in hell for a drop of water to cool off his scorched tongue. Here the rich man refers to Abraham as his father. Abraham was his father in the sense that he was Jewish. Abraham was not the rich man's father by spiritual birth. The rich man had never repented of his sins, never believed savingly in the Messiah, never received him as Lord. That's why he's suffering in hell. The rich man tried to tell Abraham what to do. Do you see that? Did you catch that? The rich man had bossed everybody around all of his life. So he tells Abraham, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus so that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool off my tongue. I'm in agony in this flame. Send somebody." Abraham, I'm sure, said, "You know, that doesn't work here, hoss." Kind of like you can tell people, if you have people under you at work, you can tell them what to do and they do it, and you go home, it doesn't work, does it? Does it? Don't act so holy. A preacher, he said, "I do this at church, 2,000 people stand up. I do this, 2,000 people sit down. I go home and do this, my wife says, take out the garbage." All right. He tried to tell Abraham what to do. He acted like he was still on earth. Then he begged for mercy in hell, but to no avail. And if you die without Jesus, I keep saying it, you're going to go to hell. You're going to go to hell. And you'll cry out for mercy and you will not receive it, not one drop of water. Misery without mercy forever. Matthew 13, 41 and 42, Jesus said, "The Son of Man will send forth his angels. They will gather out of his kingdom all stumbling blocks. Those who commit lawlessness will throw them into the furnace of fire. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." Merciless misery. And then a regretful remembrance. Oh, this is terrible. Look at verse 25. But Abraham said, "Child, remember. Remember. Remember that during your life you received your good things, likewise Lazarus bad things, but now he's being comforted here and you're in agony." This does not mean that if you're rich you go to hell and if you're poor you go to heaven. There are rich people in heaven. There are poor people in hell. Abraham said it was inappropriate for Lazarus to leave heaven to serve anybody in hell. People in hell will have memories. They'll have memories of wasted opportunities, wrong choices they made during their lives. And this rich man was left alone to suffer eternally, and all he had was his haunting memories of how it could have been so different. I read recently about one of the kings. I'm reading through Jeremiah, and Zedekiah was captured. He was the last king of Judah, and the Babylonians came and breached the walls, and Zedekiah tried to make a run for it down by the Dead Sea. They caught up with him. And the Babylonians, it says in 2 Kings 25:7, they slaughtered the sons of Zedekiah before his eyes. Now listen. Then they put out the eyes of Zedekiah and bound him with bronze fetters and brought him to Babylon. And the interesting thing is, Jeremiah told Zedekiah, if you'll just repent, if you'll just surrender to the Babylonians, you won't die. But he was so obstinate, he wouldn't listen to the word of God, and he thought he knew better than God. Do you know anybody that thinks they know better than God? And Zedekiah had a chance. He had a chance to, his kids would have been saying, I want to tell you something. Whenever you sin, it doesn't just affect you. It affects your whole family. It affects your kiddos. It affects your grandkids. It affects everybody. And so Zedekiah, what does he see? The last thing he sees before they put his eyes out is his kids being slaughtered. And so he's got to live with that the rest of his life. That's just a microscopic example of what eternal hell is going to be. Living with memories, and you have no chance to get them out of your mind. A regretful remembrance. And then an irreversible imprisonment. Look at verse 26. Besides all this, between us and you, there's a great chasm fixed, so that those who wish to come over from here to you will not be able, and that none may cross over from there to us. Not only was it inappropriate for Lazarus to leave heaven, it was impossible. Once you go to hell, once you go to heaven, you're there. I hear people talking about purgatory. The root word of purgatory is purge. And the thought is that God, yes, if you die without Jesus, you'll go to purgatory, and you will. And the concept of purgatory is that you'll have your sins purged there, and then eventually you'll come out. And it's like a spanking, and then you go to heaven. The only problem is purgatory is not anywhere in the Bible. Not anywhere in the Bible. You don't just get purged, you get punished forever. It's not a purging. And all the other stuff, you know, about reincarnation, that's the goofiest thing I've ever heard in my life. And then now, cessation. Well, God just, you know, you destroyed, you died. No, it's eternal, everlasting punishment. There's this irreversible imprisonment. Again, Jesus said it. We read it a while ago, Matthew 25:46. These will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. And then a confined compassion. Just a couple more of these. Verses 27 and 28, he said, then I beg you, Father, that you send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, in order that he may warn them so that they will not also come to this place of torment. This is where you see Lazarus break. He realizes, okay, I don't have any say-so whatsoever. This man had never, this is the only time probably in his life, he probably grew up in a very rich home. He'd been rich and telling people what to do all his life. But this is the first time ever that he realizes, this is the first time he realizes that he is not in control. How many of you know you're not in control and that God's in control? We're not in control. I have five brothers. So he wants them to get saved. The rich man begged for himself. First time he's ever. The rich man became the beggar. The beggar became a rich man. Did you see the reversal? He believed in God now. He wanted others to believe. If you die without Jesus, I've said it, you're going to go to hell. And in hell, you will wish that you could be a soul winner. You will wish that you could be an evangelist, but your compassion will be confined. I know people that on earth, they rarely will go to church with their kiddos. They might come on Easter. But you know what? In hell, they will wish that they took their kids to church every day. On earth, people mock preachers that preach the Bible. I mean, I guarantee you, if you put this sermon out all over Memphis, most of Memphis would say, that's crazy. That's insane. You don't believe that. Oh, that's ridiculous. On earth, you can mock biblical sermons. But in hell, everybody in hell would love to respond to a biblical sermon. Everybody in hell. As the flames surround them, they will wish that they could go back to earth and relive their lives and avoid that eternal mistake. Some mistakes are irreversible and eternal. A confined compassion. And then, this may shock you what I'm about to say here, a justified judgment. Hell is justifiable because of our rebellion against God. Look at verse 29. But Abraham said, they've got Moses and the prophets, let them hear them. Now what he's talking about is the Torah and the prophets were read in the synagogues all the time. And they pointed to the Messiah. And Jesus is telling the Jews this, and he's saying, you guys don't understand, but the prophets and the Torah, they point to me, and you're not listening, and you're going to go to hell just like this man did, this rich man. You don't go to heaven because you're Jewish. Jews without Jesus go to hell. Gentiles without Jesus go to hell. Anybody without Jesus goes to hell. But Abraham said, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. But he said, no, Father Abraham. He's still believing he's got authority here. But if someone goes to them from the dead, they'll repent. Do you see how Jesus is setting them up with this? If somebody goes, if somebody's resurrected, they'll repent. Jesus said, no, they won't. He said to him, if they don't listen to the Bible, if they don't listen to Moses and the prophets, they won't be persuaded if somebody rises from the dead. And he's setting them up, saying, look, I'm going to die. I'm going to rise from the dead. And they still won't believe. They still won't believe. So that's why it's a justified judgment. Because our hearts are so hard. Men, I want to say this to you. Whatever sin you see anybody commit, don't you ever say, I'd never do that. If circumstances were different in your life, I want to tell you something. There but by the grace of God go we all. Let's just walk real humbly with sinners, all right? Let's don't condone their sin, and let's don't condone ours. But let's don't be too haughty. Have you ever repented of your sin? Have you ever believed in Jesus and received Him? If not, if you die, you will go to hell. You will. And His judgment of you will be just. Revelation 20, verse 15, if anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he's thrown into the lake of fire. Very quickly, how do you avoid hell, the avoidance of hell? 1 Thessalonians 1:10. Wait for his son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead. That is Jesus, who rescues us from the wrath to come. That's hell. 1 Thessalonians 5:8 through 12. But since we are of the day, let us be sober, having put on the breastplate of faith and love, and as a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God has not destined us for wrath. God does not predestine anybody to go to hell. We are not destined to wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us so that whether we are awake or asleep, we will live together with him. If you'll trust Jesus, you can be saved. Let's bow our heads just for a moment. If you don't know the Lord, or if you're not sure, you know, when I talk to people about not being sure, I know what that's like. I remember when I didn't know if I was saved or not, back when I was 18 years old, and I made sure. If you don't know the Lord, or if you're not sure, why don't you pray and receive Christ right now? I'm not asking you to be a member of Bellevue. You may go to another church, and that's fine. As long as they preach the Bible, that's fine. If you go to a church that doesn't preach the Bible, you need to leave it. I'm not saying come to Bellevue. If you want to come to Bellevue, that's fine. But if you don't go to a church that preaches the whole Bible, you need to get out of it. Why waste your time? And why endanger yourself and your family with false doctrine? But if you would like to receive Christ, I can lead you in a prayer just like I would lead a young couple in their wedding vows. And just mouthing words doesn't save anybody, but you have to call upon the name of the Lord to be saved, and that's prayer. The vehicle through which you get saved is praying to the Lord and asking him to receive your repentance and telling him that you believe that Jesus died for your sins and rose from the dead, and to literally receive him and invite him to come into your life. If you'd like to do that, pray something like this right now. Please don't go to hell. Say this to the Lord. Heavenly Father, I want to be saved right now. Once and for all, I want to know that I'm saved. I believe Jesus is the only Savior. Lord, I repent. I turn from my sin. I'm sorry for my sin. I have disobeyed you. Please forgive me. I believe, Jesus, that you died on the cross. You shed your blood to pay the penalty for my sin. I believe you died and you were buried. I believe you rose from the dead. I believe you're alive right now. So I repent of my sins and I believe in you, Jesus. And I receive you right now. I call on your name. Please save me right now, Lord Jesus. I surrender my life to you. Wash me, fill me, and use me. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, amen. Well, thank you for a good spring semester of Men of Memphis, and I hope that you'll follow up. We've got the discipleship groups. I want to say this to you, and I'll be through. I'm all for any kind of group, but I think men do better in gender-exclusive groups. I think that more spiritual growth happens when you're just with a few men than any other kind of group you'll be in. And so if you want to know more about a discipleship group or whatever, these guys, where are y'all going to be? Robert, why don't y'all go ahead and get over there so that they'll know where you are. Y'all get over there together. Hook up with these guys on the way out. Just give them your name and they'll contact you, okay? Thank you for being here. God bless you. Have a great week. Okay.